As part of my ongoing quest to find the ultimate soldering assistant tool thing, you may remember that I was looking at this thing a month or so back, and it wasn't nearly as good for through-hole parts as I had thought. It's okay if you're looking at the component side of the board, but as soon as you've got any tall components on the solder side, or on the component side, and try and flip it over to actually solder, you know, this center beam thing here crashes into it. So that's not performance. It's okay for surface mount, which is what it was originally designed for, as far as I can tell. There you go, it's holding it nice and firm, and it's not getting in the way. But yeah, surface mount, you only really need one side of the board to get at. It could be a double-sided board, but still, you're not going to have tall components. Even something like this little pie cobbler, and you can sort of get at that side to solder it, right, if the pins straddle. But to do the other side, you're pretty much hosed. There's nothing you can do. It's just, so that's not really good for general purpose soldering. My two old favorites, though, and everybody's got one of these things, right? It's just handy for all kinds of stuff. You can even just hold two ends of wire together if you're soldering them in free space, or it'll grab onto just about any board. You can find some corner of the board to grab onto it. This one, as you can see, I've modified it a little bit. I've put some heat shrink on the grips just so that the clip leads, which are essentially these guys, right, alligator clips, so that they don't scratch up the copper or the solder mask or whatever, just for cosmetics mostly. But also when I'm working on something, if I'm working on it hot, then I'm not shorting it out. So that's a reasonable possibility. They're a little bit gimpy. It kind of crushes those, and it doesn't grip all that well. It certainly does the job, and I use it for modeling as well. It's not bad for that either. You can grab a board by a couple of spots if you want and get a good solid grip on it. And you can use the magnifying glass to let's just get down in here a little bit closer if you want to, if your eyes are getting old like mine, just to get in there and see what's going on. And actually, that magnifying glass works surprisingly well in surface mount world as well. Let's just take a look at those little 603 components. There's no way somebody as ancient as me could do those things without some optical assistance, but that's not too bad. So that's definitely a contender, although its joints get weak and floppy and stuff like that. It's okay. I do go to it quite often. Then there's this, my old Dremel device. It's essentially a clone of a Panduit Panavice. Weighted base, you can adjust that clutch and ball head and just put it anywhere you want. I typically have it something like that, and then you can clamp your workpiece into the jaws, boom, done. It's got little rubber pieces on the jaws which do a nice soft grip, but I often, when I'm soldering a circuit board, we'll take those off and just hold the board in these little grooves here. And that's nice and solid. And I can put it exactly the angle I want it at and go to town. So that's a good choice, but it's kind of big, takes up space. I'm sort of looking for other options. So when I did the video on this, and actually on fixing it, because it broke almost immediately, this was just a jam fit, so I epoxied it in there. I think you can kind of see the epoxy. When I was doing that video, I got a couple of suggestions. The first of those suggestions was from Mr. Jacobson here. His favorite, the stick vise. But then I look and it's almost $40 plus shipping Canadian. It looks like a solid item. Grips by both ends, grips it tightly. Then you can flip around and grab it by whatever you need to. That looks like a contender, but me being me, that's just a lot of money. I'm sure it's a great thing, and it looks like he's used it quite a while. Somebody else, Antonio here, suggested the jig the big Clive uses, and that's cool too, but Clive bought it a long time ago, and I don't think it's available anymore. Plus, he said it was very expensive, even by the standards of somebody who was manufacturing. So that's not really a contender. And then my old buddy GNU Religion suggested this thing from Thingiverse, a 3D printed thing. Specifically, this thing. Thingiverse, if you're not familiar with it, is a website for sharing 3D printing files. They will print stuff for you too, but mostly it's for sharing the actual files so that you can print these on your own 3D printer yourself. Assuming you have a 3D printer. I'll get around that problem in a minute. So all you do is download the files, and it downloads as a zip file. And it has in it a couple of files, a couple of STL files specifically. These two, one for the base and one for the jaws, that will instruct a 3D printer to make this thing. So I took those files and went to my local public library's webpage, and they have a thing that they call Idea Mill, which is basically a makerspace. And they have a couple of 3D printers, specifically Utilimaker 3s, which are a decent printer apparently. And you can submit a print job. Anybody who has a library card for this library can do this. You just fill in your information there, upload the STL file that you've downloaded from Thingiverse, or that you've created yourself if you want, select the PLA preference color from whatever they've got. I just put no preference, so I just took whatever color they happen to have. If you get any special instructions, submit it once for each file, boom, boom, done. So after a few days, I got an email and went down to the library and picked these two pieces up. Excellent. Except for there's only two pieces. There's only one jaw. So I went and grabbed the files again and resubmitted the jaw a second time. Again, with no preference for color. And I got this one about 8 days later. So this is the first time I've done any 3D printing. Oh, right. And it cost me $3.80 to get these printed. Which, yeah, if you don't have your own 3D printer, why not? That's not outrageous. And if I break a piece, I'm just another $1.40 and there's another jaw done. So looking at these prints, and I'm not much to judge 3D prints because this is, like I said, the first time I've dealt with it, but that face is super duper smooth. I'm assuming that was face down when it was being printed. So there's a groove there for the board to be held in. So there's the edge of the jaw on the yellow one. Was it blue or purple or whatever it is? Came out a little bit gimpier on that side. On this side, it's pretty reasonable. I don't see any other serious flaws. The only other issue I found was that these jaws are just a little bit tight going into that slot there. But I think I can resolve that just by taking a file and knocking that corner off there. So I'll do that just with one of these files, and I'll come back in a second. Okay, so after a little bit of filing and trimming, These fit in there snugly, but they do fit and I'm not jamming them too hard. And I think that's what you want. I don't think you want too much weeble wobble in them. But then they go on there like that. And then to hold them clamped shut, the thing called these an elastic band vise. So you just do that. So let's grab a random board here. This is a fairly large board. So let's see what happens. Will it fit in here? Yes. That's held fairly firmly, actually. I guess if you want more hold, just put another band on. I suppose you could put, you know, a bigger band or more, whatever, on there. I mean, those are cheap and available, right? Hell, some of my stuff from China comes with elastic bands wrapped around them. Well, that works. And you can pop it out fairly easily. But that's just about... Well, it's still a little tight, but that's okay. But that's pretty much the extent of it, of the size of it. And just for reference, my cutting mat's in inches, so that's, what, 4 inches that way by 2 inches that way. And that's pretty much the longest board that it'll hold. Let's get some sensible measurements in here just for the rest of the world. What is that, 8.5 centimeters by, well, and you can go as wide as you want, right? I could clamp this board in this way. Get that up out of the way. Does that hold in there? That being flush to the edge is kind of getting in the way. Okay. Let's try a different one. I guess for this one, I'm going to have to tighten it up that way. That's a bit of an inconvenience, but it's not an expensive inconvenience. And that's holding it there and dangling out. And again, that's holding it solidly. Oh, that's reasonable. How much time have we got left? Let me throw a real kit in here and fire up the soldering iron and just get going on that. We got in the bin of kits. Here we go. This is an Arduino Nano screw shield. You want to start on one side here, I guess. Get some magic blue putty. Generic from the dollar store, so it's not actually a blue tack. Carrying on with the theme of cheapness. Pretty straight? Sure. Okay. Just clamp this guy in. Okay. Let's just start soldering, I guess. That's my skill. That's not... There we go. That's not bad. It's light enough that I can pick it up if I need to, just to get a different angulation on there. So that's just both ends tacked. I'll take my blue blob out. That looks fairly perpendicular. Okay, so... The only way that, I mean, it's holding it solidly, that's good. The only way that I could see a real problem is if the PLA plastic that it's made out of gets deformed from my soldering iron being too close. I'm not really seeing that as a problem. If I actually touched it with the soldering iron, yeah, that happens, but that took a second. That wasn't completely instant. I'm just going to cruise along here, not paying any attention to the yellow plastic, paying attention to my soldering, which, as fun and relatively easy as soldering is after you get some practice, it's surprisingly difficult to do a good job of it on camera. I'm kind of arm's length here, just because of where the camera is on the workbench, and to get this centered, well, it's not even centered, so that you guys can see what's going on. Let me zoom in a little bit more and get that. That's a fair distance away from me, so I'm working at arm's length here. But it's still pretty good. I'm steadying my hands on the base of this thing. That helps because it doesn't have a lot of weight to it. It can skitter around pretty easily. But with my hand on here, that steadies it. My other hand is actually, let me just zoom out here. My other hand is actually resting on my soldering iron holder, just to keep everything steady. And just because I am working almost at arm's length away from myself here. But that's done. More importantly, focus right there. Right. Hey, damn it, focus. Do I have to use AVE's magic words? There we go. Okay, so there's a little bit of damage on there, but nothing too significant. It's mostly just discoloration. It's a little bit of deformation, but that's not affecting the jaws at all. So that's probably the biggest worry that I have with this thing. That and pushing too hard and breaking one of those tongues down there. But this being PLA plastic, I can use my 3D pen to fix it, or I can heat it and stick it back together, or hot melt it, or crazy glue, something like that. That's interesting. Wonder how it's going to work with an odd shaped board. What is this? A metal detector kit. So this is still pretty stiff. You have to pull it back parallel. But will it hold it by that round part? Yeah, that's surprisingly solid. Obviously, you could hold it by that part. And that's reasonable. There's a couple of spots that are a bit close to the edge, but again, that's completely reasonable. What else have I got in my box of kits here? That's a pretty odd-shaped board. Let's see if I'll grab onto that. Yeah, that's not going anywhere. What happens if I spin this around here a little bit? I have to pull on both jaws. They're sort of being sucked towards each other. Okay. That's not bad. And yeah, I can move it down to that end again if I want. So I can have my hand rest there. Even grabbing onto that weird part, that's odd. And I like that you can adjust the tension. I think that might be a bit of a winner for now anyway. Where's a small board? I mean, that shouldn't be an issue. Yeah, that's not a problem. Or I could also put that board in t'other way, I think. This is a little bit of a pain in the ass, actually, because the jaws keep going to go towards each other. Okay, that maximizes it. It's holding it, but that's right on the edge of the world. But it's doing the job. I think I'm going to use this one for the next couple of kit builds and just see what happens. And I'll finish this guy off camera because that's just boring for you guys to watch. Anyway, if you got any comments on this, let's hear from you down in the comment section below. If you got a preferred soldering tool that I haven't heard of and that I hadn't been told about in the comments, I'd like to hear about that. Give me a link if you've got one. That'd be cool. Anything crazy expensive, obviously, I'm not going to go for because I'm a bit of a cheapskate. And unless you want to go over to Patreon and make a stupidly large donation, that'd be awesome. And then, yeah, obviously, I'll do it. But, I don't know. Let's see what you guys got to say. Thanks for watching. I will talk to you later. Oh, the beer. I didn't introduce the beer. The beer is from Winnipeg Brew Works. It's their Pilsner, crafted in true German style with patience and precision. Light color, flavor balanced. Yeah, the sign at the liquor store said that it was malty. I'm not really picking that up too much. 20 IBU, so low hops. Makes me happy. I know some people love big hops. I ain't one of them. Anyway, yeah, another cool local beer. Thanks for watching. Talk to you later.